So you're in the market for a new vehicle and you want something with some extra space to go along with an added sense of safety and comfort. You're probably thinking crossover, right? The Kia Soul, well, it just might make you think twice with tons of room for people and stuff to go along with a budget-friendly price tag. Okay, so let's just clear something up right out of the gate. I'm not some sort of anti-crossover crusader. I just hate seeing people spend money on a vehicle they don't need. And I say the same thing to people in their pickup trucks. Why buy a vehicle like that if it doesn't suit your lifestyle? It's just a waste of money. And the same rule applies to a crossover. Why buy one when a car like the Soul will suit your needs more than fine? Now that also brings us to our first misconception that somehow ride height makes a safer vehicle. Driving something taller off the ground doesn't make it any safer. And what makes things safer in terms of driving position is good visibility. And that's something that the Soul does better than just about anything it competes with. We'll get to the styling in a bit, but let's first talk about the overall shape. Because it's basically a box on wheels, and what that means is it's got great outward visibility, it's got nice and big windows, and it gives you a great view of what's going on around you. Compare this thing to a crossover of the same size, and the height advantage is obvious from the belt line up. But more important than just the big windows is that the driver's seat is height adjustable, so you can raise it or lower it as much as you need, and that gives you that commanding view of the road that most people are looking for when they shop for a crossover. Now let's get back to that misconception about ride height for a second. If you're thinking that a crossover rides higher, well, you're wrong. This thing actually has the exact same ground clearance as a Hyundai Kona or a Honda HR-V, and it's about half an inch taller off the ground than a Mazda CX-3 or a Toyota CHR. The other advantage this thing has over a crossover of the same size is that because it has that boxy shape, well, it doesn't have that tapered design in the back, so there aren't those windows that squeeze, and you have great rearward visibility as well. You know, all of us here at autoTRADER.ca love the Hyundai Kona, but those of us on the taller side know that headroom is seriously compromised. That's far from the case here though, and as you can see, I have tons of headroom. I don't feel cramped or constricted, but it's the back seat where the real story lies. I barely fit in the back seat of the Kona, but as you can see here, I have a ton of headroom and legroom, even with the driver's seat in my normal seating position. I'm really impressed with how this thing is packaged. You know, that guy really knows what he's talking about. Hey, don't sell yourself short either, buddy. Let's go get some pizza.
The back doors also open nice and wide, which makes it easy to load kids and car seats into the back. Now, the trunk is the same thing. The hatch has a nice and wide opening. Cargo room stands at about 530 liters, which isn't that great, but it does have a handy trick in that the load floor can actually be lowered, and it increases cargo room by about 25%, and it grows to 660 liters with the back seats up. Now, it is a tall and upright space, but it is very, very usable. No, this thing isn't quite as versatile as the HR-V when it comes to carrying cargo, but the back seats do fold relatively flat, and when you do stow them, you get 1,750 liters of space, which is competitive with a bigger vehicle like the Ford Escape or Mazda CX-5. That's pretty impressive, and again, it comes down to the height of this thing. You also can carry taller items without having to find a way to lay them flat because of that taller roof height. So we've covered all the ways the Soul's shape make it practical and useful, but it also makes it unique, and it's something of a survivor. Think of the Scion XB or the Nissan Cube. Those things looked pretty much identical to this thing, but they came and went, and this thing is still sticking around, and it goes to the longevity and the kind of cult-like following that it's developed over the years. So Kia was wise to make sure it kept all of those ingredients that made this thing special to begin with, but modernized it a bit. Park this thing next to any of the two previous versions and you can tell that it is a direct descendant, but I will say it has a much more mature look this time around. The previous versions I always felt were kind of cartoony, and aside from the sleepy-eyed look that the headlights on this thing give, I think it actually is a pretty attractive vehicle, and it is modern, it is updated, and it looks grown up. The same goes for the interior. It's a nice layout, it's a clean, simple space. Everything is well laid out and well identified, though it is plagued by the same problem that Kia and Hyundai have faced for years, and that is a lot of cheap plastics inside, especially the door panels. They just feel really hollow and cheap, and I don't like that. I also don't like the amount of gloss black finish they've put in this GT line model. This stuff is absolutely terrible when it comes to fingerprints and dust, and it's just not a good look that actually ends up cheapening the look overall. Cheap plastics aside, there are a lot of higher end features available in the sole, including this massive 10.25-inch touchscreen. Now, it's a widescreen format, and that makes for a really cool interaction when it comes to Apple CarPlay. Maps are nice and wide, you get a nice view of everything in the area, and you're not really straining your eyes to see what's going on. The same thing goes for the infotainment system itself. It runs Kia's Yuvo infotainment system, and it's one of our favorites. It's very smooth, it's very simple to operate. Overall, it's a great infotainment system, and it's up there with Uconnect from Fiat Chrysler as one of the best on the market. In keeping with the Kia tradition of throwing just about any feature you could imagine in its vehicles, this thing gets a lot of other features as well, and most of them come into play on more affordable models. Heated seats are standard, but you only have to step up to the second trim to get a heated steering wheel as well as a wireless phone charger. Two other key features are the fact that you can get ventilated front seats and heated rear seats, which aren't even available on the 2020 Ford Escape I drove recently. And that thing's about 15 grand more than this top of the line. Now, I am driving the fully loaded GT line limited trim, so it gets the heated steering wheel, the heated and ventilated front seats, the heated rear seats, that big infotainment system, navigation, you name it. It's really decked out. It also gets some cool exterior styling elements like a unique grille and some cool contrasting color accents that really step up the look of this thing and give it kind of a sporty character. And that brings me to my only real disappointment, in that Kia Canada decided to discontinue the turbocharged engine in the Soul for this third generation model. Now, I reached out to Kia Canada for comment on this, and they told me that the take rate on the turbo engine was just too low to justify bringing it back. But that's a real bummer, because that's exactly what this thing needs to match the character of the chassis and the handling. No, this thing isn't a sport compact car, but it is nice and agile and nimble, and it's also pretty comfortable. Now, it's that agility that makes me miss the turbo engine the most, because the only engine on offer here, well, it's not anything to write home about. This 2-liter, well, it's serviceable, but it's far from spectacular. It makes 147 horsepower to go along with 132 pound-feet of torque, and those numbers aren't terrible. Acceleration isn't exactly abysmal, and it's about what you'd expect from an engine like this. But it's what it's paired to that's the real problem, and that's a continuously variable transmission that makes me miss Kia's automatic gearboxes. It's just really loud and buzzy, especially when you put your foot into it, and it's probably one of the worst on the market, to be completely honest with you. Subaru, Toyota, Honda, they all tend to be better, and they've done a better job of really kind of quieting them down and making them feel like a bit more of a traditional automatic transmission. I also wish Kia would put paddle shifters in this thing. I just feel like they would add a little bit more liveliness to the drive, give it a bit more character, and help when you're passing slower traffic on the highway. Give you that ability to downshift with your left hand and upshift with your right on the fly without having to reach down to this shifter. And I also find moving the shifter is a slower way to shift gears. It doesn't really respond as quickly as a paddle shifter. The steering has virtually no feel, but at the end of the day, this is a commuter car. Now, when we talk about suspension comfort, well, if you've driven a Kia in recent years, you'll know just how drastically improved the ride quality is. It's not perfect, and it's not as good as something like a Honda Civic or a Toyota Corolla, but it's drastically improved, and rough roads aren't as problematic as they used to be. That's especially complimentary when you consider Kia still uses a torsion beam rear suspension, basically a steel bar that connects the two rear wheels and has coil springs on either side. But those tend to lead to a little bit more chatter over rough roads and not as much comfort as you'd like. A lot more road noise gets into the cabin when you go over rougher surfaces, but it's a pretty impressive ride overall. The ride and handling just has a real car-like quality to it, and that's because, well, this thing is a car. Which brings us to our last car versus crossover argument, and that comes down to the availability of all-wheel drive. No, it's not offered here, but if I've said it once, I've said it a thousand times. Most Canadians don't need all-wheel drive, and definitely don't need all-wheel drive as a replacement for winter tires. This thing actually has a great amount of traction and grip with the Yokohama tires that Kia Canada has put on this thing, and it definitely is more than enough for most conditions. Now, one big silver lining of Kia not offering all-wheel drive here is that it keeps this thing really, really affordable. The starting price is a little high, it's around 21 grand, but it only ranges up to a little bit over $29,500, and that's really reasonable considering all the features you get. Again, you're talking a heated steering wheel, heated seats, wireless charger, 10-inch touchscreen, ventilated front seats, heated rear seats. This thing is about as decked out as any mainstream vehicle, but it won't break the bank. My tester is priced out at just under 32 grand with freight and fees, and that's not a lot of money for the amount of car you're getting. To quickly sum up what I like about the Soul and what I don't, I'm giving a thumbs up for the great visibility, amazing rear seat space, and overall affordability the Soul offers. Getting a thumbs down are the buzzy transmission and the lack of a turbo engine option. Say what you will about Kia as a budget brand, but there's no denying the improvements that have been made to its vehicles over the years, and the Soul is exhibit A. No, it doesn't offer all-wheel drive, but it has a ton of features to go along with a ton of space for your stuff. And best of all, it won't break the bank.